Hello, my name is Brandon, and welcome to the next video in my series on basic statistics. In this video, we will learn about three common variable transformations, namely the square root, logarithm, and multiplicative inverse. So of course, like, comment, share, and subscribe. Let's get to work. First, two quick review slides from previous videos in this playlist, and I promise I will go through them very quickly. So why do we transform variables in the first place? We transform variables to conform to regression assumptions, which amplifies predictive power and increases the overall quality of the model. The metaphor I use is like a car that's not tuned up. So if your car is not tuned up, it will run, but it won't run optimally. So we go get the car tuned up and everything's working properly and it runs much better. Same thing here. We transform variables to fit to the assumptions of regression, and that cascades down into better predictive power and overall model quality. So four primary reasons why we might transform variables. One, to even out the variance. Two, to normalize a variable. Three, to linearize the regression model. And four, to reduce the impact of outliers and high leverage observations. I went into more detail about those on the prior videos, so check those out if you want to go more in depth about these reasons. We are using the Boston dataset in this example, so all the variables are numerical, and here is each variable and what it measures. We're looking at two primary things here at first when determining whether or not we will use a transformation, and if we are going to use one, which technique. So the first element to look at is the skewness direction. So of course, if a distribution is right skewed, the long tail is to the right, as you can see over here on this example. And of course, the opposite is true for left skew. If it's left skewed, then the long tail is to the left. So the first thing we're looking at is, one, is our data skewed in any direction? The second thing we're looking at is the magnitude of the skewness. So here we have right skew that's relatively mild. The right tail is slightly longer and the distribution is kind of shifted over to the left. So it's right skew, but it's relatively mild. Here in the second example, we have right skew that's moderate. So the tail to the right is longer and the distribution center is moved to the left. The third example here is a right skew that is severe. We often call this an L-shaped distribution, like the letter L, because almost all of the data points are over to the left and it has a very long right tail. Now, of course, these are all right skewed, but it can happen to the left as well. So this fourth example is a left skew that's severe. We would call this a J-shaped distribution, like the letter J. Now, oftentimes what we will do if we have left skewed distributions mixed in with right skewed distributions, we will reflect the left skew distribution to make it right skew. That way they are all going in the same direction. And it's very simple to do, it's very intuitive, and I will talk about that here in one of our first examples. First, we have the square root transform. On the left, we have the distribution for the variable PT ratio in the Boston dataset. PT ratio stands for pupil-teacher ratio. It's also known as student-teacher ratio. And it makes sense. We have a low of about 12 students per teacher on the left side, and then a high of about 22 students per teacher on the right-hand side. Now, this is skewed to the left. There's a long tail to the left, but it's relatively mild. So we might implement the square root transformation. So we'll go ahead and do that. And the distribution now looks like this. Now you might be saying to yourself, if you look at the numbers, this doesn't make sense. Well, that's because I did a reflection. Since the distribution on the left is left skewed, I went ahead and reflected the variable. It's like the button on your phone that switches a picture vertically from one way to another. For example, if the text on your shirt reads backwards, you hit the button and it flips it. And now the text on your shirt reads properly. Same thing here. And the way I did that, and we'll go into this in more depth in a future video, is I just took the maximum value on the left-hand side, which is about 22, I believe, added 1, which would have been 23, and then subtracted the value that's in the distribution on the left. So the effect of that is that it flips it vertically. So now the data was right skewed, and then I took the square root of those numbers. And that is the distribution we see over here on the right. Next, we have the logarithmic transform. So here is the distance variable. So I do believe that this measures the distance of the home from a city center, I believe. So we can see here that this is more pronounced. The right skew is moderate. If we took the log base 10 of those values, or the natural log, which is the log base e, we would see what we could get. So I took the log base 10, and this is the result. Almost perfectly normally distributed if we apply the curve to these values. So we can see that this transform had the exact effect that we wanted. Now a note here as well. So all values must be greater than or equal to 1 to use the logarithmic transformation. So I had to do a little bit of math here as well. So all we did was make sure the lowest value was 1, then we took the logarithm. If we do not, we'll end up with negative values. So mathematically, we usually add a constant to our data set so that the smallest value is 1. So here is the residual plot after doing that logarithmic transformation. So here's without the transform. We can see our residuals are packed over on the left-hand side. They kind of have a V shape. And then on the right, we have our residual plot for the transformed. That's what DIS underscore T represents. If I were to do this again, I'd probably name it DIS underscore T underscore log 10, so I knew exactly what I did to that. But since I'm doing this video, I know what it was, but it is good form to maybe put in the redone variable and the transformed variable exactly what transformation you did. So here we can see that our residual plot is much better. It is spread across the entire range. It's very compact vertically right around the zero mark, and that's exactly what we're looking for. So notice how the V shape in the residuals is gone, and homoscedasticity is better after the transform of the log base 10. So here is the distribution versus the residuals. So here was our original distribution, and here are the residuals for that distribution. So you can see how they go hand in hand. Here is the transformed, and here are the transformed residuals. Again, right down the middle, evenly spaced, very compact in towards the zero line. Multiplicative inverse transformation. So here is the age distribution in the Boston data set. So some of these houses are very old, as you can see here. So this is a J-shape distribution. It is severely left skewed. So here we might try the inverse, which is just 1 divided by the value. And we do that, and we get something that looks like this. Now pause here just for a second, because I had to explain why this looks the way it does. So the transform distribution is skewed right. So what we see over here on the right after it's been transformed, it's skewed right because other techniques needed to be used to avoid division by zero. So as you can see here, if we have 1 divided by the value, that value cannot be 0. So we had to do 2 things here. Number 1, we reflected the variable. So it's left skewed. We would like to work with all right skewed distributions, so it was reflected. Then we had to do a little bit of math to make sure that we weren't dividing by 0. Now what you can see here is there are a few data points way out to the right on this right distribution. So that is skewing the data from a more pure normal that we would like to have. However, we expect those things to happen in this case because of the nature of working with the inverse here. So imagine that those few points over on the right didn't really exist. So what that would do is make this distribution on the right look a little bit more normal. So that oddity in the distribution on the right is expected, and we just have to know that it won't affect our analysis really in any way. It's just a nature of the process of doing this transform. So here are the residuals for the age of the home. So without a transform, it looks like this. We can see they're all pushed over to the right, kind of have a V shape. We can see that with the transform, it's much more compact around zero, spread out across the axis. With the exception, we do have those few points over on the right, again, that like I said, they're just an artifact of the transform itself. So notice how the V shape in the residuals is gone, and homoscedasticity is better after age underscore T transform of reflection and inverse. So, like I said, the values at 1 in age underscore t are artifacts of the transform and are expected. So, distribution versus residuals. Here's the original data. We can see that the residuals match the data points. After we do the transform, it looks like this. That wraps up this overview of three common variable transformations. Just to review, we have the square root for mild skewness, we have the logarithm for moderate skewness, and then we have the multiplicative inverse for severe skewness. And also recall that if the distribution is left skewed, we will almost always reflect it. So it's right skewed. All of our distributions are right skewed if they are skewed. And then we can work from there in the same form and fashion. Also recall that if the distribution is left skewed, we will often reflect it. So it's right skewed. And then all of our skewed distributions are going to the right. And also that some of the techniques, namely logarithms and the inverse, require some other techniques, so we are not in the logarithm situation taking a logarithm of anything under the value of 1. And of course, for the inverse, we can't divide by 0. So sometimes we have to add a constant or do something simple like that to avoid those mathematical issues. So I hope you enjoyed this video on common variable transformations. Again, my name is Brandon. Thank you very much for stopping by and learning with me. I wish you all the best in your studies and hope to see you again soon. Take care and bye-bye.